Welcome to Brush Creek Holiness Church's Good Friday service. We're going to take the time to go through the events from all the way from the Last Supper all the way to the crucifixion. Myself, I'm going to be doing the Last Supper. Chris McGuire is going to be doing the Garden of Gethsemane. Ethan Cotton will be doing Peter's denial and the trial of Jesus. And David Smith will be doing the crucifixion. So if you would, turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 26, verse 17. Matthew 26, verse 17 says, "Now the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying unto him, Where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? And he said, Go into the city to such a man, and say unto him, The master saith, My time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples. And the disciples did as Jesus had appointed them, and they made ready the Passover. Now when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12. And as they did eat, he said, Verily I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful. And began one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? And he answered and said, He that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. And the Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. But woe unto him, unto the man whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been better that that man, if he had not been born." Then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? And he said unto him, Thou sayest. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and blessed it, and brake it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, Take, eat, this is my body. And they took the cup, and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it, for this is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." You know, this story here is talking about where Jesus and the 12 disciples were eating the Last Supper together. And Jesus told them that one of them was going to betray him. And you know, in Matthew's account here, it says that each one of them said, Is it I? You know, that is it I could have been any of us. It could have been you. It could have been me. We know he was talking about Judas, but yet it says here that he said, Is it I? And Judas asked, Is it I? And he said, Thou sayest. But you know, I think that Jesus kind of hid it from the disciples. Because, you know, when Peter knew that he had been betrayed, what was Peter doing? He pulled a sword out and cut the guy's ear off to protect Jesus. I believe if Peter knew that what was going to go on, that Peter would have tried to stop Judas. But in another account, I want to let you see that John actually knew who was going to be the one that betrayed him. In John chapter 13, verse 21, it says, "And when Jesus had thus saith, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, Verily, verily, I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. Then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spake. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of the disciples whom Jesus loved. Simon Peter therefore beckoned on to him, that he should ask who it should be of whom he spake. He then lying on Jesus' breast said unto him, Lord, who is it? So Peter told John, because John was the one that it says that Jesus loved, and he was the one leaning on Jesus' breast. And Peter asked him, said, John, ask Jesus who this is that's going to betray him. And here John did. He said, Who is it? And then it says, and Jesus said, he it is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then Jesus said unto him, thou doest, do quickly. Now no man at the table knew what intent he spake unto him. For some of them thought, because Judas had the bag, that Jesus had said unto him, buy those things that we need, that we have need of, against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. John knew exactly who it was, because he asked Jesus, and he told him, he said, the one that I dipped the sop and pass it to, this is who is going to betray me. And you know, John had to be so close to him that he could hear his heartbeat. So close to him that he could literally just whisper, and nobody else in the room hear, but John. You know, as the church, we need to make sure that we are so close to God that we hear what the voice of God is. We need to make sure that during this time and all the times that we're being the church, that we're exactly where John was, so close to Jesus that we can hear that voice and act on it. During this time that we're in right now, the church needs to be the church. We need to stand up and do what God wants us to do, whether it be feeding people, whether it be ministering to people, whether it be calling and checking on people, going and getting groceries for people, whatever it may be, a way that we can be of service, we need to be doing that. You know, Jesus was betrayed by his friends, by his friend Judas, and yet Jesus still loved him. He was one of the disciples. You know, he was right in the presence of God at all times with Jesus. But yet he still betrayed him. He still fell. He still fell short. And you know, we can do that too. But we need to try our best to be more like John and be as close to him as we can. During this time of this Passover and the Last Supper, it was a very important thing for Jesus to actually take the communion with them. And he felt like it is an important thing or he wouldn't have done it. And he gave him an example and told him, said, this is my body that's going to be broke for you. Take it, eat it. And then he gave him the juice and said, this is my blood shed for you. Drink it and drink it all. And today we just need to remember that on this day that he did the Last Supper, he gave us an example of what we should be and who we should be. And that's how we need to live our lives every day, especially during this Holy Week. Thank you all.
We're going to be reading from Matthew 26, verses 36 through 46. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto his disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and watch with me. And he went a little farther, and fell on his face, and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, what, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then cometh he to the disciples and saith unto them, sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. Jesus comes this Thursday night to the garden just outside the walls of Jerusalem, right on the Mount of Olives. He asks his disciples to watch and pray with him. He takes three of his closest to be with him in that intimate moment in prayer to God. In this small way, we see how necessary that what Christ is about to accomplish at the cross truly is for us as human beings. For we have this question that still pierces even at my heart today. Could you not watch with me an hour? And I'm reminded so much of my own sins, reminded so much of my own failures. Could I not do the simplest things? Yet Christ did it all. Christ was the very one who redeemed us from our sins, who made us be partakers of his goodness, of his holiness, of the joy and love that we could not accomplish because we were weak and we fell asleep. And here in the garden, we see here juxtaposed these two, Jesus Christ, fully God, fully man, truly God, truly man, and brought here into this place of Gethsemane, sorrowfully, and yet his disciples slept. Even sharing in this moment of agony with Jesus was more than the disciples could take. When we have Jesus here troubled and distressed, we see that the weight of the world, the weight of the sinfulness of the world, is soon going to be placed upon his shoulders. In his truly human nature, the words of Psalm 42 speak very loudly. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil against me or within me? And you think of the words of this psalmist, of the distress and the difficulties, and may we even say the depression that the psalmist faced here. In the same kind of way, we see that Jesus is agonizing in this garden. In the text, it talks about that his sweat became as great drops of blood, that it was that kind of an agonizing prayer to the Father that this cup could pass from him. Because he knew what was about to take place. He knew the ramifications of the sinfulness of human beings and knew that him going to the cross and taking upon himself all the guilt and shame of every single one of us was going to be in his human nature the toughest thing, the most horrific thing that any human being has ever had to endure, and yet he's going to take it upon himself. And yet the psalmist continues, just as Jesus did in his plea in the garden, hope in God, the psalmist says, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. While Jesus cries out from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? There's a realization that this is God. This is his Father. And that's where his hope is going to be placed. That's where he's going to depend, my salvation and my God, realizing that because of his truly divine nature, because he is truly God, that this will not be the end. Knowing that this Gethsemane prayer, that this cup maybe, if it be possible, could pass, but if not, he depends upon the Father, his will be done, and knows that this will not be the end. That's the kind of hope, that's the kind of belief, that's the kind of trust that the Son has for the Father. In his humanity, his sinless human nature, he's keenly aware of the horror of the cross and if there be any other way for this cup to pass. But Jesus makes it very clear, however, that he intends to fully comply with God's desire. Jesus' hour has come, and his disciples lay asleep. Jesus' hour has come. And oftentimes our lives continue. We reflect back on what Jesus Christ did, and sometimes we fail to remember and reflect, even during this Holy Week, of how important, how significant, how profound that what Jesus did during this week is to us as human beings. And he knows, Jesus knows, that there is no other way to bring these disciples who are sleeping in this moment of agony back to God. And he knows that for you and I, there's not another way. There's no way that we can do it. There's no way that we can get back to God. Oh, but by the cross, by his suffering, by his death, we can be brought back to God. Hebrews 5:7 says this, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears upon him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him.
Matthew 26 and 33. Peter answered and said unto him, though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended. Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto thee, that this night before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. Peter said unto him, though I should die with thee, yet will I not deny thee. Likewise said all the disciples. Now, we talked about Peter, but first I want to look at Jesus' trial, and then we'll come back to Peter in just a minute. Matthew 27 and 11 says, and Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, art thou the king of the Jews? And Jesus said unto him, thou sayest. And when he was accused of the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. Now at that feast, the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. And one thing that I want to point out is Barabbas is not just a regular prisoner. He is a notable prisoner, which means that this is not the first time that he has been arrested. He obviously has had many different occasions that he has committed a crime, which is why that Pilate refers to him as a well-known felon. Verse 19 says, when he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, have thou nothing to do with that just man? For I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate saith unto them, what shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all said unto him, let him be crucified. Matthew 27 and 23. And the governor said, why, what evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. And you can see that all throughout these verses, that Pilate knows that Jesus has done nothing wrong. He knows that he is innocent. Verse 18 says that Pilate knew Jesus was delivered by envy of the people. He knew that it was jealousy that led the chief priests and the elders to capture him and lead him to his trial. His wife in the very next verse says, Pilate, you better not have anything to do with what happens to Jesus. He is innocent. I've suffered many things because of a dream that I had about him, and you better get away and not be involved with whatever happens to him. So in this situation, God is giving grace to Pilate. God says that I know Pilate's heart is pure. He says, I do not want you in the mess that the people who are claiming that he is deserving of death, I don't want his blood, Jesus' blood, to be on Pilate's hand. So he sends a dream to his wife, warning him to stay away from whatever they decide to do with Jesus, knowing that either way, no matter what, Jesus has to get to the cross. But God is protecting Pilate to not let it be through him and by him. Verse 24 says, when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather atonement was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. Then answered all the people and said, his blood be on us and on our children. And what I really want you to take from this is how important it is that you listen and obey whatever God is speaking to you in your life. Because you can very easily be persuaded to the side that says crucify. Pilate very easily could have been persuaded to that side, but instead he washes his hands and said, I am innocent of the blood of this holy and righteous man. Now in chapter 26, we see Peter is telling Jesus and all the disciples that you all may leave him, but I'm staying right here. Even if I gotta die with you, I will be with you until the end. Jesus then says, Peter, you will deny me three times before morning even comes. Matthew 26 and 69 says, Now Peter sat within the palace, and a damsel came unto him, saying, Thou also was with Jesus of Galilee. But he denied before them all, saying, I know not what thou sayest. And when he was gone out into the porch, another maid saw him, and said unto them that were with them there, This fellow was also with Jesus of Nazareth. And he denied with an oath, I do not know the man. And after a while he came unto him, they that stood by, and said to Peter, Surely thou art also one of them, for thy speech bewrayeth thee. Then he began to curse and to swear, saying, I know not the man. And immediately the cock crew. And Peter remembered the words of Jesus, which said unto him, Before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. And he went out and wept bitterly. Peter, after being broken and failing Jesus, he says to the disciples, he says, I'm going fishing. Who else is going with me? In other words, Peter is saying, we've all messed up. We were all scattered the night that Jesus was taken. Now Jesus is gone. Now I'm going back to the old me. I'm running back to what my flesh knew. I'm running back to where God delivered me from. So Peter, at the time that he said that I will not deny you, he thinks that he is in a place that he cannot go any higher, that he cannot be any better, that he cannot elevate himself. He thinks that in terms of his level and spirituality through Christianity, that he has reached the maximum level that he can go. But that is so wrong that God has to allow him to fail. He allows Peter to be broken. He allows him to go down. He can say, you're still on earth. You're still walking by the flesh, and I'm not done with you. No matter what you believe in your mind, I can still elevate you. I can still take you higher and to another level. Acts 2 and 41 says, Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. So God allows Peter, or sends him to mess up, so that on the day of Pentecost, Peter can stand up and preach probably the greatest message that Peter has ever preached. He stands up and he's preaching to thousands after the Holy Ghost had fell and the anointing of God had fell on him in the upper room. He is preaching to thousands, and on that day alone, through his brokenness, Jesus allows him to reach 3,000 new souls for the kingdom of God. But God had to make him fail so he could take him to a higher level than he thought he could ever go. And something that I want you Christians to know is that oftentimes it's not Satan that allows us to fail, or the flesh that allows us to fail, but it's God who sends us or allows us to fail, just like Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Jesus allows Peter to fail so that he can take him to another level. He can take him to another place of anointing, and that he can reach thousands of people on the day of Pentecost. Because I want you to realize that the Peter that says that I can't go any higher would not have been able to reach the thousands of people that he reaches on the day of Pentecost through his message. So I want you to know today, a few points I want you to take is, no matter if you fail, no matter what you do, you don't turn back to where God has delivered you from. Don't ever go back to the sin that God has delivered you from. Another thing that I want you to take from this is that through every trial, through every situation, no matter what you're facing, that God is going to try to grow you through this and the devil is going to try to destroy you. And you have to make up your mind that no matter what comes my way, no matter what's going on in my life, that God is still in control. He is still my Savior. He is still my God. He still died for me, and I'm still going to live for Him no matter what comes our way. And that is the hope and the assurance and the faith that we have in God, that no matter what, we trust Him through it all.
Today we're going to talk about the crucifixion. The first thing that comes to my mind when I think about the crucifixion is the cross. As I travel around, I see crosses on the roadways, on the sides of the roads where people have put them up. And I see people wearing them for jewelry around their neck, like neck with necklaces and things like that. And I've even seen people that have tattoos of crosses on their bodies. You look and you see crosses on church buildings and all kinds of other buildings, you see crosses. But I just wonder sometimes, does people really understand what the cross really means? It's one of the most common things that Christians can agree on. Whether you're Pentecostal, Holiness, Baptist, Methodist, whatever, we can all agree that there's something about and something special about the cross. Paul spoke of the cross as His glory. Galatians 6 and 14 through 15 says, "But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world." Paul could have found many things to glory in. He is credited for writing around 8 books of the New Testament. We could also find many things to glory in. The stone was rolled away at the resurrection. So why don't we wear a stone around our neck instead of a cross? Or why don't people put tattoos of stones on their bodies instead of the cross? It's because the cross is a symbol of life, a symbol of eternal life. Cross is the only way to everlasting life. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come to the Father but by me." Jesus even talked about the cross before the crucifixion. In Matthew 16, 24, Jesus says, "Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." I'm sure you've heard of this power that's in the cross, and I'm sure you've heard preachers say that there's power in the cross, but where does this power come from? They laid Jesus down and on an old rugged cross, and they pierced him in his hands and in his feet. They put a crown of thorns upon his head. They hung a sign that said, "King of the Jews." The cross was meant for humiliation. It wasn't meant for glory. They mocked him and they spat on him. And Jesus even felt forsaken on that cross. He could have come down, but he chose not to. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he didn't. He gave his life that we, you and I, might be able to be saved and that we might have a life. The cross is where Jesus took on the sins of the world. Yours and mine were included that day that he took on those sins. We have a cross as our symbol of love. 1 John 4 and 16 says, "And we have known and believed that the love of God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him." John 3, 16 also says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The cross makes us worthy, for we're not worthy on our own. Romans 3 and 23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Isaiah 64, 6 also says, "But we are all as unclean things, and all of our unrighteousness, and all of our righteousness is as filthy rags." Revelations 5 and 1 through 14 gives us hope. It says, "And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?' And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open the book and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders saith unto me, 'Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof.' And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sateth on the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sung a new song, saying, 'Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to the God by the blood of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hath made us unto our God kings and priests. And we shall reign on the earth.' And I beheld, and I heard a voice, many angels round about the throne and the beasts and the elders. And the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, I heard saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever.' And the four beasts said, 'Amen.' And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever." Jesus made us worthy. He made us worthy because he is worthy. In the cross lies our hope. The sins of the world were cast as far as the east is from the west by the crimson blood that ran down an old rugged cross on a hill called Calvary. The crucifixion of the Son of the living God. That's why, that's the power, that's what the cross means. Have you in times past just seen the cross as a religious symbol? Today I ask you to look at the crucifixion a bit deeper and to take your sins today to the cross. It is our only hope for life. Jesus said that I have came that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Today I ask you to choose life through the power of the cross. And if you would today, would you say a prayer with me? If you don't know Jesus today, I ask you in this time that we're living in this day and hour that we live, I ask you today, are you ready? Are you ready to meet Jesus today? Are you ready to give your sins, to have them cast as far as the east is from the west today? If you're ready for that today, I'm just going to say a little simple prayer here that you can follow along with me. Our Father, which art in heaven, Lord, I just ask you today, Lord, to look on me that I'm a sinner. And Lord, I have sinned and I have come short, Lord, of your glory, Lord. Lord, but I know today that through the cross, Lord, that you gave your Son, Lord. Lord, that by his blood, Lord, that I might be saved, Lord. And I believe, Lord, that he was buried, Lord. Lord, and that he rose the third day. And Lord, I just ask you to come in my life today, Lord, and to forgive me of my sins, Lord. Lord, for I know, Lord, that there is power, Lord. Lord, in the cross, Lord, and in the crucifixion, Lord. Lord, of your Son, the Son of God, Jesus Christ.